So let's talk about the origins of the AMM disorder. So what about the child that cannot conform to the parent's narcissism? What about the child that has limitations? Say they're born with ADHD or ADD or an anxiety disorder. Of course, we don't diagnose infants and toddlers. What about the child who was just born to say no? I had one woman at a training a couple months ago said she had fraternal twins, and as she breastfed, and she said, and I thought it was the most perfect image, she breastfed the children at the same time, and one was so cuddly and warm and just so sweet, and the other one was really rigid and cried all the time. And she couldn't comfort one baby, but could comfort the other. This child, who is unable to live up to the AMM's fantasy, is labeled as willful and difficult. The AMM personalizes the child's inabilities. The willful child is punished, neglected, or abused. It's victimized by the AMM's rage and narcissistic injuries or indifference. This child is raised in a much more damaging and psychologically harmful environment than the child that figures out how to adapt by pleasing or being the gifted child, the trophy child. This child is afraid of triggering the AMM. This child can't figure out that secret recipe of how to make their mommy or daddy smile and be this wonderful, cute child. This child, in essence, becomes a threat to the AMM. AMMs resent this child's badness. They project their own personality traits onto this child. Whether they call the child selfish, ungrateful, bad, you're just like your father, you're just like your mother. This is really a pronouncement of who they really are. The child who can't be controlled or changed is a victim of retaliation, abuse, or neglect. This child lives with dread and fear. This child has a different life than the one that figured out what to do. This child is constantly resentful and angry at the parent that never could love them. This is a child that does not attach to adults. This is a child that doesn't trust adults. This is a child who develops a selfish and hostile worldview. But a child who feels unloved, who feels like they're an object of a hatred, they're a disappointment, that develop this idea that the world is similar. And that is the core and the very beginning foundation of where emotional manipulation disorders start. Without warmth, acceptance, and unconditional love, or even conditional love, this child closes down emotionally, loses hopes for ever being considered lovable. This child learns that they are essentially unworthy, that the world is unsafe, and that to rely on only themselves, because only through their own efforts will they feel good about themselves. They learn that they can't figure out how to get people to love them. They can't figure out a way to coax the parent to pick them up, to cuddle with them, to feed them. Their view of the world is a place that is everyone is out for their own. Shame and anger accumulate as the child learns that he or she and the AMM are indeed separate and will always be separate, that the AMM's needs are always more important than theirs, that love and safety never come, and criticism, neglect, and abuse are the norm. This is a child that grows up feeling that they are a burden to their parent, and they can't figure out how to reverse that. Because once they are labeled as the bad child, the problematic child, they carry that all the way up into adulthood. Failed attempts to be loved create a foundation of shame, distrust, and neediness. We can see when we were talking about the origins of codependency, we saw the seeds of codependency being planted early on by the way they interface with their parents. Now we're seeing the seeds of what will become a personality disorder. There's a foundation of shame, distrust, neediness, self-doubt, and rage. Great amounts of rage. Because the shame is too unbearable to accept, it's relegated to the unconscious. We know that through the study and the knowledge of post-traumatic stress disorder, when trauma is too big, is too unbearable, that our minds cannot process trauma, we have what I call a circuit breaker, that when we will push it back into our unconscious as a way to cope. That is how the human mind works. When we can't handle something and it's too horrible, we detach, we disconnect, we disassociate, or we repress it. this early childhood experience of being abused, neglected, and feeling unloved is relegated to the unconscious, locked behind iron walls of denial to resist any and all attempts of recovery, only breaking through with bouts of narcissistic rage, which explains why the emotional manipulators don't seek help, because they can't remember or don't understand how damaged they are because they had to block that all away. So the person who is born to an emotional manipulator that abuses and neglects them, who survives by pushing it back into their unconscious, they do not remember their childhood. Because to remember is to re-experience how horrible they were treated and how lonely and disconnected they were in their childhood. Like the child who is born to be a codependent, the child who is born to be an emotional manipulator has to cope, has to survive. To survive deprivation, neglect, and abuse, they have to come up with survival strategies to stave off anger, frustration, and humiliation, to deflect or ignore their lack of importance, to buffer the pain of neglect or abuse, to repress rage for being neglected or abused, to acclimate to depression, to deprivation, or loneliness. A child who was deprived and forgotten and not talked to might be much more damaged psychologically than the child who was screamed at, yelled, and hit. So it's important to understand that an emotional manipulator sometimes comes from a family in which there was no abuse.